Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Turtle in a Half Shell, Turtle Power. Hey everyone, Randy Joe here, and this is 1001 Reviews, where I plan on listening to every single album from 1001 Albums to Listen to Before You Die. And today we are looking at X-Ray Spex's 1978 album, Germ-Free Adolescence. According to the book, Germ-Free Adolescence from the X-Ray Spex was released under the Virgin label, produced by Falcon Stewart, with art direction by Cook Key, Trevor Key, and Falcon Stewart. Nationality UK, with a running time of 35 minutes and 46 seconds. Now, going into the X-Ray Spex Germ-Free Adolescence, I wasn't sure what to expect, as I knew this was a punk album and was held in high regard in the punk community. But I wasn't aware of the fact that this album was also an incredible blend of new wave as well, as the new wave and punk blend do come together quite strongly on this album. Perhaps some of the best blend of the two that I've heard myself. And with this being a punk record and a new wave record, you do get some things added to the mix that you wouldn't necessarily expect. For example, a huge element of this album is the use of a saxophone. And the saxophone all of this album played by Laura Logic is placed in very delicately all over the album, as you get it in certain spots where it takes up a portion of the track as a solo. For example, in the song Warrior and Woolworth, which is one of the most catchy and poppy songs off of this record, you have two saxophone solos that take up both the first half and last half of the track, being sandwiched between vocals by polystyrene. And this song is also a great example of the new wave and punk genre kind of melding as one, as it has got the upbeat punchiness of new wave, but still has the very direct and dirty punk stylings that punk is known for. Another great example of the saxophone on this album is on the 11th song, Plastic Bag, in which the saxophone provides almost like a backdrop to Polly's vocals when things in this song greatly slow down and she is speaking much clearer and with less energy. It is much more direct to the listener and is softer to the ear, and the saxophone provides a nice warm backdrop to her vocals. And this is contrasted greatly by the very fast-paced and riffy guitars that make up the chorus of the song, as the song does switch and shift back and forth between being riffy and fast-paced and slow, laid-back, and direct. So this contrast is very well balanced over its runtime. And is actually probably one of my favorite songs on this album, as it is very enjoyable to, I think, most people, as it is still very accessible and displays just how diverse the band is as well. Another thing this album has going for it is the overall themes of self-image and anti-consumerism. As for self-image, you have the title track, Germ-Free Adolescence, which is about a girl and a guy who end up finding each other and falling in love as they are a perfect match for each other because they are both so obsessed with being clean and being as tidy as possible, to the point that it is dangerous, I would argue. She speaks about how the girl cleans her teeth 10 times a day, and as she sings this vocal delivery, it is almost cracked in a pained way, because brushing your teeth 10 times a day would be painful to an extent, and displaying this within the song and using this vocal delivery kind of adds to the personality of the track and conveys the point overall. And if you really want to know how absurd this cleanliness is there's some very funny lyrics in here that kind of portray that. Lyrics such as, "You may get to touch her if your gloves are sterilized, rinse your mouth with Listerine, blow disinfectant in her eyes." And the last two lines especially really add so much in terms of humor and personality to the track, while at the same time driving this point home of just how clean this girl is attempting to be. To the point of blowing disinfectant in her eyes is so silly and absurd, but is very much a issue of self-image. And not only is this song clean literally, it is also quite clean production-wise, as it is the most well-produced song on the entire album and sounds extremely crisp and clean, with every single instrument just being polished around every edge. And I would also argue that this song is one of the funkiest ones on the album and kind of detours into a funk-like element as well. And then as for the anti-consumerism lyrics, which are pretty much all over this entire album, you have the song Plastic Bag, which I have mentioned, which have the lyrics, "My mind is like a plastic bag that corresponds to all those ads. It sucks up all the rubbish that is fed through by ear. I eat Kleenex for breakfast and I use soft hygienic Weetabix to dry my tears." And by dropping these product names, she is sort of advertising for these companies and saying how these companies are controlling what you do, to the point where switching Kleenex and Weetabix in this example, you will follow exactly what they tell you to do in the ad. So using Weetabix to dry your tears isn't something that is sensical, and just like eating Kleenex wouldn't be sensical. But if these ads were to tell you to do just that, the people will follow them mindlessly and do just that absurdity. So it really drives the point home of just how strange advertising is and how much power it has over the people and how strongly against that X-Ray Spex is. And then you have the song Genetic Engineering, which lyrically may not be the most incredible, but I think thematically and story-wise is one of the more interesting songs on here, as X-Ray Spex are predicting something very, very distant in the future, especially at the time of release in the 70s. As she is speaking about how people are creating AI and robots that will soon replace our day-to-day jobs and soon just replace humanity overall. And this is something that is already being done in the real world to some extent, with people losing their jobs for example, self-checkouts and cashiers losing their jobs. So this is really driven home in this song all the way back in 1978. And one last thing I would like to give some more praise to is the runtime of these tracks being mostly shorter than 3 minutes long, and very few being longer than 3 minutes. And this is important to mention because, like I've said before in previous reviews, I think one of the greatest things about punk is the directness of it and the very punchy straightforwardness of punk. And by having this straightforward, direct punchiness, you should also not drag it out too long. And most great punk records do take note of that. Most great punk records have songs that are 2 minutes to 3 minutes tops, and anything exceeding 3 minutes usually shifts quite a bit in terms of tone, because that is a great way to strengthen its longevity. So with X-Ray Spex, most of these songs being at 2 minutes are this great punchy, riffy, fast-paced drum solo built tracks. They have so much going on within the span of 2 minutes that it is very direct, just like punk should be. And when it extends outside of the 3 minutes, for example the song Germ-Free Adolescence or the song Plastic Bag, there is more being brought into the genre and there's more being brought in to diversify its sound a lot more. So the X-Ray Spex definitely have a great understanding of how punk works and how to write a great punk song, because they never abuse the runtimes in any of these songs. I think the only con I can really give this album, the only really negative that this album has, is that some of the tracks do feel a little bit dated and a little bit campy. But given the time of this release, which was in the 70s, I'm willing to give it a pass, as most of this still feels very relevant today and still feels very strong today. But I do think when hearing it, you can definitely tell the time frame that it came out in. Despite the fact that many of the lyrics are still true to this day, instrumentally, this thing is still a product of its time. I think things like the saxophone do freshen it up a lot more and do give it a longer lifespan overall. But other than that, this thing does feel like a bit of the past, which I guess isn't the worst thing, as there are a lot of great albums from the 60s and 50s even, that even though they sound dated, are still just as beautiful today, compositionally speaking. So that doesn't give a huge hit to this album overall. So in the end, the soft rating of this album still came to a 8.2. And I will harden that to a 8.2. It's not changing. An 8.2 is pretty strong still, and I think this is one of the best, if not the best, punk new wave record I've ever heard in my life. And I will also go ahead and say this is essential, as most of the tracks on here are extremely enjoyable, and this is definitely essential for punk fans. This might be some of the best punk you'll ever hear. And also arguably the most underrated punk I've heard, because this is a pretty obscure band to the general audience, at least from what I can tell. All right, let's go ahead and see what the next album we have to listen to before you die is. All right, 1 to 1001. 795, which is 795 being Elastica, self-titled. Go ahead and give that a listen, and that will be reviewed and released in exactly 1 week from now. And on this Friday, we will have New Order's Low Life to review and look at, so listen to that one as well. If you like this video, please leave a like, and if you have thoughts on this album, go ahead and leave them below, as I would like to hear more thoughts and more general discussion about each album as I go along. And please hit subscribe to follow along in listening to every single album from the 1001 Albums to Listen to Before You Die book. The link to this exact list is actually in the description below if you want to see exactly what's on there. This has been Randy Joe, signing off.